World Graphical.
I add value through my products.
I am an animator.
I am a filmmaker. I develop trends.
I transform designs to reality.
I create environments.
I translate stories to furniture.
I design experiences.
I'm an immersive media designer.
I design mobility.
This is not only a design institute.
This is a design lab.
Join us in our design movement.
Good evening. Welcome to 8th edition of MITID webinar series. I am Professor Binod John, Head of Department of Animation Design at MIT Institute of Design. Here I am with Swaroop Dev, Creative Producer and Managing Director of Girgit Studio Pune. Welcome, Swaroop.
Hello.
In this edition of webinar, we will try to enlighten students with our discussion on art, technology, storytelling in animation design. Also, we will address to the questions of our live audience through Q&A. So, Swaroop, like when the animation started, you know, so there is always, you know, that it's been understood as a cartoon, mm-hmm. and it's purely for entertainment.
Still understood as cartoon.
Yeah, still understood as a cartoon. Okay, so we would like to start with animation now and then. When I started, it was we used to wait for one fine Sunday mornings when those specifically He-Man. And Donald Duck, those kind of cartoons used to come, and those were the one specific day. Today, thanks to the channels, a lot of cartoons, a lot of contents are there. Okay, if I talk about in terms of content, it was purely gag, fun cartoons and all that. Today, if you look at in terms of content, okay, those are good messages, experiences, those has been transported. In terms of technology, if you look at that technology, it was purely traditional. Okay, and today you look at the technology, the way it is getting exploded. It's a new pathway for all together as a team. How do you see yourself?
Well, I was fortunate. My initial days of upbringing began in Russia, Moscow, when my father was posted there. He used to work with the Indian Air Force. And I grew up watching a lot of Disney, of course. But I was lucky enough to be exposed to a lot of Russian animation that time.
Okay.
I remember watching a show called Nu Pagaji, which was basically, you can say, a Russian version of Tom and Jerry, which involved a hare and a wolf. And also I used to remember watching a very beautiful stop motion late night show for kids. I only remember the opening sequence. It's a beautiful stop motion. The song was also va-yu-va-yu-na-ra-ra-ra-da-ra-ra, and I used to fall asleep there. That was my initial days of animation. Yeah. And then mostly it was about watching Disney, and then we came back to India, and the thing that I used to look forward to was, of course, Sunday morning Mowgli, the Jungle Book.
Yeah, absolutely.
So
right,
totally grew up like that. Music, I think it was done by Mr. Vishal. Vishal Bhadwaj, like the best of the people would come together and present those shows. And so most of Disney, I would say, is what groomed the initial days. And when we, I did my post-graduation in animation from NID. And during the NID days, we were exposed to a lot of different other kinds of animation, which I feel I was lucky to be there in that institute. A lot of faculties from abroad used to come, and they would share their works. So then a whole new world of animation opened up to me, where we would see various types of mediums, we would see various types of animations in terms of content. And then apart from kids, there is a whole different zone of using animation that opened up.
Okay.
Like animation for adults, there is animation for adults also, and then apart from that, various applications of animation, be it gaming, be it architectural walkthroughs, and within that, what kind of experimentation various people across the world are doing, that opened up for me at least. So I think nowadays, yes, there are quite a few very good shows, and I think the opening up of YouTube was another big boom where a lot of players started their own animation studios, and a lot of YouTube videos were made mostly around nursery rhymes and the preschool zone. And TV definitely still holds the majority share of broadcasting animation. Films, like I would still say, we have to look forward to the films coming out of Pixar or the world or towards the West. During NID again, yeah, I was exposed to the entire Japanese animation films, Miyazaki films. And those were mind-blowing. I had never seen those kind of visuals. I remember the first film that I watched as a grown-up when I was looking to join the animation design school. Before that, it was after my engineering. So there was a screening in IDC in Mumbai, in Powai. So I happened to be invited, and I was through a friend, and I watched the film screening of there, and the film Grave of the Fireflies was screened. And I remember I watched the film, and I didn't even meet the film the friend who invited me to watch the film. I took the bus. It was like 45 minutes ride. I had just tears rolling down my cheeks, and I didn't want to speak to anyone, and I just went home. And I that day realized the power of animation, that you know, it's not just fun gag, but it can really touch hearts, and it's purely, I would say, power of storytelling. That beyond the initial 5 or 7 minutes of the film, I forgot I'm watching a cartoon film, I would say. I was totally immersed in the story. And yeah, that's what I feel is the power of animation, and how it can engage anyone.
For me, when I started, it was purely cartoon entertainment and all that, and I'm into this transition period, how this technology and everything has been emerged, and the storytelling is coming with that cartoon. With now the people understanding animation, what it is, and today I think animation is everywhere. You open your mobile, your laptop, you go to website, animation is something.
It's become a lot easier.
So lot more those things.
You have been in that time, I think, where you know they used to shoot in the Oxbury camera.
Yes.
So that
is something I would like to mention. When we started, it was an Oxbury camera, no? So and today it's everything digital and technology, which helping out.
Now
so,
you can see those Disney documentaries where they would show that how each layer of the animation would be painted in the drawn, painted in the slides, then kept in layers, and then it will be shot from the Oxbury. And then everything was like one take. You can't redo anything.
Absolutely.
So now it's much easier, I would say, in terms of technology. Yes, digital has revolutionized everything. But I would say it's something similar to what is happened with photography, for that matter. Like earlier, when you used to just shoot with a film camera, you would, and you know that you have to go through the pain of developing that film. You would be more conscious about what shot you are taking and how you are framing it and what aperture setting and all that. Now with digital, you're like tuck tuck tuck. You'll click 1,000 ones and then you'll pick one. Okay, this one looks good. So, but again, I would say with the reference of the photography analogy, that you know, there's this joke that a good photographer was invited over dinner at someone's place, and the the lady in the house, she was like, "I really love your photography, and so really good photograph. So what camera do you use?" So he was like, "Okay." So then he just mentioned, "Yeah, I use this brand camera and all." And then after the dinner, he finished the meal and he said, "You know, I love the food. So which gas stove did you cook it on?" So, so it's not about the equipment that you're using or the technology you're using. Definitely, it can add a you know, ease to the thing that you're doing. But at the end of the day, it's the person behind the camera. It's the hands that are putting the spices that makes it delicious and presentable.
So if we just summarize, it will be like at that time when animation was earlier, it was limited, less exposures and all that. And today, those who are in this era, they are definitely in an advantage side, because there is a platform, there is online, you can easily collaborate, there's a lot of exposure, films are traveling across and all that. So it's a good time, and with technology, a lot of visual complexity comes, but at the same time, it's given a lot of freedom. And you know, creativity to the directors in
definitely.
So now the next question which I would like to ask, because that is something we as a designer always think about, what is there to design in animation?
Okay, so that's an interesting question. I asked when I joined the first day at NID, our coordinator Shekhar Mukherjee was there. Mm-hmm. So I said that, you know, so he had given us an introductory talk and everything that about cinema, about film and how animation is another, you can say, a visual expression of storytelling, a visual expression of cinema. And then my question to him was that where is design here?
Design.
The course name was animation film design. So it could be just animation film making. So what is design here? And he left the answer. He said, you know, you have 2.5 years to explore that. Why don't you tell me after the end at the end of the course? And I think I slowly put together my answer to that. And see, for that you have to understand the difference between what art and design. An artist basically expresses. He has certain ideas in their mind. He wants to do certain experiments, and he just works for himself, and he creates an expression, and he puts it out in the public, and he leaves it to the interpretation. Of course, he's keen to know how people are reacting to it.
Yeah.
But then his attitude is that this is my expression. Whether you like it or not, it's up to you.
Right.
So if you say just filmmaking, then that is filmmaking.
Okay.
It's an art. But when you call it film design, then a lot of thing becomes conscious. A designer now, everything becomes people-centric. Now everything becomes audience-centric. You understand what the purpose of the film is. You understand, is the film the purpose entertainment? Is it advertisement? Is it to promote? Is it to educate? So after understanding that, you would understand that who is the target audience, who is going to watch it, where is it going to be screened?
Screened, right.
Then how the audience is going to consume it? Is it through a phone? Is it on the cinema in a cinema hall? Is it online on a OTT platform? Where exactly you are going to look at it? And then basis that, then you will understand. Then you will find out, okay, what is the theme, or is there a purpose of the video that is required? So basis that, you make a lot of conscious decisions,
right?
And around those conscious decisions also is a expression, is an attempt of innovation. Mm-hmm. Where the artist within the designer comes into play, where he says that, you know, a lot has been done already here. Mm-hmm. So why don't I try something different as well?
Right.
And putting all those elements together, when you are putting together a film with those conscious choices, it becomes a process of design. And and that is where I would say is lot to learn and lot to understand that how a film is put together.
Right. So when I look at, because when I started animation, people used to understand it's just a movement. Yeah. Yeah. So something is there, it's moving to one place to another and that. And a lot of small institute training center does that. But rightly you said like design there for animation. Yeah. So there is a design. What you said is that.
I wouldn't belittle that effort as well, because I see the requirement of both. So while there is a requirement of people to think what should be made, there are also people required to execute it to that finesse.
Right.
So it's not enough that I could think of a brilliant movie in my dreams, then how do I present it out to the audience? So to present it out, I do need people who can visualize and who can materialize my dream.
Yeah.
So at max, as a designer, I can instruct that, you know, this is how I see the film. But then also there is a requirement of people who would put in the sweat and blood in that and actually help it take up a shape.
Yeah.
So that aspect is also required. But then I think it's very important for the institute as well as the aspirant, as the student, to understand that where they want to be, what space they want to be. Do they want to be in the space where they are thinking, or they want to be in the space where they are executing? And I personally respect both aspects of the entire scope of things.
Right. So for me, when I was thinking about it, when there is just a movement, it's a technique, you're just executing it.
Hmm.
But when you design it, it's planned well, okay?
Yeah.
There is a certain emotion, even if it's just a simple object, it has characteristic. So that is what design comes in. And that's what we, as a design institute, teach animation design.
Right.
Okay, so now when coming to design, I would like to understand role of design in Indian animation industry, because a lot of training centers over there, and everyone teaches in terms of techniques and mediums and all that. But in terms of design, how do you see role of design?
I would go back to when we started out Girgit. So way back in 2011, we passed out from NID, and we wanted to make a mark. My partners Anuj and Avinash, we used to be flatmates, roommates since day one. And that just a month before our convocation, we were all like, I and Anuj were cooking. Avinash was back home with all bankrupt. He was trying to finish his diploma film. And then I and Anuj were talking that, hey, what do we do after we pass out? And I was like, oh, like coming from a job-oriented background, I was like, no, I have to take up some job. And Anuj was more brave in that sense. He said, hey, why don't we start out on our own? And we were like, but why? Like, you know, we have education loans and this and that, a lot of burden. We don't come from affluent families. Mm-hmm. So, but he said that, you know, after we pass out, how many NIDNs do you remember as animators who have made a mark? So people, some like, if you don't do something really consciously, you will, you know, just fizzle out in the crowd. So let's work for ourselves. Let's make our own. And we were fully charged up, and we said, okay, fine, let's call Avinash also. So Avinash, we are starting. And he was like, what? I can't. He said, yeah, we are starting. Then luckily we got a project from PepsiCo. And
PepsiCo.
Yeah, so that so we were the fortunate, you could say that. No, so it was the first project before even we passed out, the convocation was pending, and we got that project. And in 10 days, we delivered some 1.5 minutes of animation from conceptualization to the final delivery. And that too, I and Avinash knew zero about Flash. We had never handled Flash. Right. So within 10 days, we learned the software, we delivered a film, and that boosted our morale like anything. This, yeah, we can do. And when we started Girgit, we knew one thing, that we don't want to be a production house.
Yeah. Right.
We wanted to be a design studio coming from. So maybe at that time, our understanding of design was also not as mature. We just that we had a stamp from a design institute, but we were also still understanding what design
what
meant.
Design is all about.
And but we were sure about one thing, that we don't want to just become executors. That was something we were sure of. We wanted to plan.
And I think
our own content.
That's what all design institute teaches you.
That teaches you, it gives you the confidence of taking up a project, thinking about it, executing it, and delivering the end product.
Right.
So it gives you that confidence for sure.
Absolutely.
So with that we started. And coming back to the question that you had asked, that, you know, when we talk about Indian animation industry, I remember in 2009 when I was in 2006 when I was thinking of getting into the field of animation, I read articles and all where they talked about the boom in the animation industry.
Right.
And I was like, oh, there is a whole lot of money. And I was imagining myself like, you know, Uncle Scrooge diving in his pool of money. And so I was like, yeah, I have to be in this space. And later on, I realized that, you know, a lot of this money that is being talked about in the animation industry is coming from, a major chunk of it is coming from the outsource industry,
right,
where projects come from abroad, and they come, they look at India as a place where production is done at
you get a talented artist.
You get very good artists, yeah. But the main deciding factor is that you get cheap production, and you
right.
you get, you have professionals who will deliver you on time. Definitely these factors do count.
Right, right.
But yeah, it was looked at as a place where you will get cheap production. So we, coming from Design Institute, didn't want to go into that space. Mm-hmm. With due respect to all studios who
studios
work in that
work
space,
there,
but
yeah.
We wanted that, you know, why can't we dictate the terms of what the content should be like?
Right.
Of course, because of the background we were coming from. So I think a lot of studios who started out as outsourced studios have now put together their internal teams. They are churning out their own IPs. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people there are self-taught, like who have been earlier executing maybe outsourced projects. Mm-hmm. But now they are also, they have developed the skills, and they are also designing the characters, designing the storyline, and delivering. And a lot of self-taught artists have emerged.
Right.
But definitely I would say that a designer with a certain training in design would be able to contribute more effectively in this industry, and the and animation industry still doesn't know what impact animation designer can make, and the industry has a long way to go in understanding that.
Okay, I'll move on to next question. Design thinking, because when we're talking about from Design Institute to role of design, this is one important aspect of design. When you specifically beat any design project, design thinking in mainstream animation industry.
There's no one definition of design thinking. I would say design thinking is about making the entire approach people-centric. That, you know, you understand that what is the requirement. So it begins with empathizing. that whenever you're working on any theme, you say, so at Girgit Studios, we have worked on various social themes. We have worked on films on child sexual abuse.
Yeah.
We have made a short film on female feticide. Recently, right now, we are working on a film on women entrepreneurship.
Right.
So whenever we are working on themes like this, immediately, you know, the first thing is that, yeah, I know a lot, I have read upon a lot and, about, you know, gender equality. I know what female feticide is. And basis that, we can right away start writing the story and making the film. But that is where design thinking stops you. It says that, you know, whatever you're doing intuitively right now is just from the top of unconscious knowledge that you have gathered.
Right.
But here the first step comes with empathizing. So first thing you have to go is find out who the film is for. Reach out to them, interview them, talk to them, understand them, empathize with them. So there comes the first pillar of empathizing. And then after you empathize only, then second stage would come where you will sit down and ideate. Now ideation could be through brainstorming, but there are many other ways of ideation as well. So where you will find out what are the possibilities in which I can solve this problem that I have taken up, these people are facing or this issue I have taken up. And after that phase of ideation, you then find, so during ideation it's kind of a divergent process,
right?
So you open up, you just try to confuse yourself that all this can be done, and then you again sit down and say, now I go to a more convergent process where I now shot down, okay, this cannot be done, that cannot be done, basis, you know, what is the timeline available, maybe resources available, viability and finance and everything you consider, and then you come boil down to, okay, this can be done. And then the third stage come, which is basically the testing phase, or you can say prototyping phase. And design thinking basically encourages you that, you know, before you invest a lot of time, energy and your mind power into taking, shaping up the final product and then realizing, oh, this doesn't work, you try and quickly make some prototypes, you make animatics, or you make some a comic strip, and then you quickly reach out to your target audience and you see that how they are reacting to it. Is the story working?
Yeah.
Are the characters relatable? And then again you go back to your storyboard and you modify things. So by this, following this process of going back and quickly testing, quickly failing, basically to arrive at the best design as quick as possible, and that's the purpose of design, right?
Yeah.
That you know, a Lota is considered to be a very good design. It was during the founders of the Charles and Ray Eames couple that came to start NID. So they said that Indian Lota is a beautiful design. But then that design took maybe 1,000 or 1,500 years to come to a shape,
yeah,
and become. So the purpose of design is to basically, I would say in simpler words, is to speeden up the process of evolution.
Right.
So over evolution period of time, things will evolve and it will take a shape and it will become a good design. But through design thinking, you can make crunch that timeline of 1,500 years to maybe just 10 months.
Yeah.
And you quickly try out multiple things and you come up with a solution which solves the problem.
Yeah. Well said. Well said, Swaroop. Since our webinar topic itself is animation, art, storytelling, and technology, how do you see these things are influencing the animation itself?
Well, animation, I would say that whenever you watch a film, art serves the purpose of catching the eyeballs. So if you remember that when animation started, there was already live cinema there. The Lumiere brothers had invented the camera and they would shoot films. But why did animation evolve? Because people wanted to see inanimate things move. They wanted to see their drawings move, their art move. And that was a new experience that people wanted to see.
Mm-hmm.
So definitely, a beautiful art moving is the, you can say, catcher of the eyeballs for the audience. But it ends there. Beyond a point, it doesn't hold the audience attention. Maybe beyond the first, as I said, in the Grave of the Fireflies films, that film that I watched, beyond the first few minutes, I forgot that I'm watching, some drawings move. The next thing comes is the technology, I would say, where it definitely helps you visualize or bring to life your artworks. So what kind of art can be brought to life? So earlier you would say that it would be very simple drawings that would be brought to life, but now you can actually see a entire sculpture or a 3D object coming to life. So that is what is the power of technology, that it breaks the, it keeps pushing the boundaries of what can be seen moving. So there comes technology, but the binding.
We can look at one small animation where you can see Van Gogh painting is getting into that. So a lot of new trends and techniques are coming where painting, which was a still, now it is getting animated, and then you can get a walkthrough to that. So those are the videos which we are playing for our audience. So it's a beautiful, that topic, the painting is Starry Nights, and it's been getting animated. Yeah, so next, so getting into the next question of our webinar, like what are the future trends you are looking in animation?
Well, future, I would expect, at least in India, when I'm seeing, I would like to see more innovative topics. I really am looking forward to see what Gitanjali Rao has made, Bombay Rose. So I see a lot of Indian storytelling there. I really loved what Shilpa Ranade has done with Gupi Gawaiya, Baga Bajaiya. And I would like to see more Indian stories coming out in terms of cinema and what experimentations are done in terms of storytelling as well. And also I would see how audience matures more in accepting animation and it breaking the boundaries of just remaining as cartoon films for children, for kids. And I think a lot of that onus also falls on the filmmakers like us. Like if you see a Pixar film, say for that matter Coco, so they make a film from the point of view that it is a story that they're telling, which is viewable by kids also.
Okay.
So they design the film keeping that in mind, that this is a family film which can be watched by kids.
Kids.
But the problem is that so far when in India, when we are making films, we somehow start the process the entire way around and we say that hum bachcho ke liye film bana rahe. We are making a film for kids, and then we lose out on a huge audience because the kids don't go buy tickets and go to the theater. It's their parents or their uncles they will take, right, or aunts will take them to the theater. So I think that unless we can overcome that mindset of making film for children, animation, at least the feature film industry will face this issue. Apart from that, I would say other avenues of future trends would be in terms of how storytelling is intervened in spaces like VR or augmented reality or virtual reality.
Right.
So those are spaces that even we are quite excited about. Like in Girgit, we were a few days back, we were also exploring what can be the storytelling format in VR. Because right now, if you see, VR is all about that you wear the headset and it's just one space and all you can do is turn around your head.
Yeah.
And then within that one space, the story is happening. But we would be interested to participate and become a part of developing the language for VR. So if you remember, in cinema, the film language developed over some time. Earlier, it was just the camera kept by Lumiere Brothers and the train is passing and it's whatever is getting recorded is what people watch. That was the initial thrill, and I think that is the stage right now VR is in.
Yeah.
But then over a period of time, then it shifted to maybe a theater kind of stage enactment happening and the camera recording that. But then slowly people understood cuts, they understood what cinematic storytelling is. They understood that, you know, by taking a fade out and then again fading in shows passage of time. So this language was developed by filmmakers and the audience also grew accustomed to that and they subconsciously started absorbing that. So we are totally looking forward to see that how that language develops in virtual reality space. And
when I look at it, it's like a four eyes. One is innovative, immersive, interactive, and intelligent. So you hear a lot about artificial intelligence. The thing which you talk about AR and VR, and so this is going to be the new platform. And the technology is something. The progress you can't stop. Basically, at least you steer it up.
But so I always believe that apart from technology, what will hold the audience is storytelling.
Yeah.
And storytelling beyond a point, as I said, the art can hold maybe the initial few seconds can bring right. people to the theater. The technology can push it further by making them see that, oh, that wow factor, that okay, this this experience has been given to us.
Yeah, yeah.
But finally, what the audience will leave the theater with yeah. is the storytelling. That is what they will yeah. remember.
So one quick last question, two liner maybe. What are the skills required for an animator, or maybe into animation? What skills required someone to do animation?
I think the one basic skill that even at our studio we say that animation as an animator must possess is observation.
Right.
So it all it boils down to how good or how well observer you are.
Yeah.
And if you have learned to observe, you have covered like 50% of the ground, and rest of it is practice. So a combination of a good observer and your dedication to practice and sharpen your skill will make you a good animator.
Yeah, for our audience, I'll quickly play a video which talk about the different fields where animation contributes. So it can be it is creative arts, it is medical, it is aviation industry, it is automobile, education, especially if you look at Baiju's footage, advertisement, majorly it become marketing and promoting tool. And today if you look at animation become a business tool.
Yeah,
a lot of business is happening over the animation, like you have an animation film clip and that's how it's marketing.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we will move on to our questions if from live audience, sure. if we have some questions, question and so on. Yeah, this is Swarup. This question from Janvi. What does it take to be a complete animator? Yep.
Complete, okay.
Complete animator.
That's an interesting way to say it. So now I would like to answer that question by again bringing back the question that what aspect of animation are you talking about? When you say animator, it is restricted to the part of you adding life to an inanimate object.
Yeah, right.
So that's the restricted role of an animator. And to become a complete animator, as I said, you have to be a good observer, and then you have to have the perseverance and patience to execute whatever you have observed and bring life to the object. So that will make you a complete animator. But then again, you have to also understand that what role you want to play in, as I said earlier, in the entire gamut of things. Like you want to be the animator who thinks and decides what should be animated, what stories should be told, how it should be told, what medium it should be told in, and then the production part of it comes where you actually add life to objects and you tell the story to finish the final thing. So
right.
within that scope, where you are placing yourself would depend what you mean by complete animator.
Complete animator. Yeah, there is one more question from Neha. Can you throw some light on animation and game design? How do you see? Because animation becomes so integral part
yeah,
of
game design cannot be even thought without animation.
Animation,
so
right,
even absolutely. If the basic game you remember, you know, that Pac-Man game I remember to be playing.
And it does have a storytelling. There is a character art.
There is a story involved. Yeah. And again, if you see the design, so the design is always trying to marry between what is the requirement. The requirement is that we want a game to be entertainment.
Yeah.
Then it marries that what is technologically possible. That at that time you have those computers with very basic computing capabilities,
right.
graphic cards are basic. So if you look at the brilliant design of the Pac-Man characters, is taking into mind of the graphic card abilities of the thing, and at the same time the last objective that comes is the economics part, the viability of the project. So so design, I would say, and at the same time animation is the very integral part of gaming industry. And now I think like it's crossed all limits, and yeah. animation you can't even make out that you are playing a game, or it's the real life that you are experiencing.
Yeah, there's one more question from Abhijit. Swarup, the question is that how far is India from bridging the gap between Indian animation and that of West and Japan? We all born seeing Pixar and Japanese movies, and where do you see Indian industry is going to contribute? Because right now industry is not that organized, or maybe it's a scattered and
it's
lot
there.
Of
it's
there.
It's yeah, catching up, I would say. It yeah. is catching up. But then I think Indian animators or Indian animation storytellers, I would say, have to stop trying to copy either West or Japan. So Japan could have its own identity despite over powering and a flourishing American or Western animation industry was because they were telling their own stories, and their storytelling was also very unique to them. So until we Indians understand and so again in India there are extremes that when we say Indian stories, we either go back to Jataka tales or we go back to, you know, Panchatantra.
Yeah, right.
So we feel that Indian kahani means that only. But what is Indian storytelling is something we need to still explore. Like even if you consider the mainstream cinema or what you call the Hindi cinema, so that also began with stories, mythological stories like Raja Harishchandra, Santoshima and all those things. Yeah. But then over a period of time, Indian film industry understood that what is unique to us and what is the unique storytelling style in live action film. So similarly in animation, I think we have to still discover what that uniqueness we are bringing in animated storytelling is and how it pans out.
There is one more question from Aman. Since you having a studio, okay, and the question is like, studio look what kind of portfolio? How does someone design a portfolio? That's a question, because once you graduate and everyone talk about the portfolio, and that's on base of that portfolio you get work. So
right.
what do you like to see in a portfolio?
So first thing is I would say that I can talk about my kind of studio as in design studio, because there are different kinds of animation studios also. There are VFX studios, there are gaming studios, there
right.
are animation production houses, and there are animation design studios. So particularly in our studio, we totally don't value a degree. So
okay.
A lot of students will just give their CV and they will say that I have this degree and that, and they don't even put up a portfolio or a showreel, and that resume is immediately rejected, because or we at least just say that, you know, why don't you share your portfolio and then we can process that. But yeah, so degree doesn't count for sure. So if you are planning to join any institute to get that degree, then you know, that's not a
right.
wise thing I would advise. But what we value is the what you have learned and what you can exhibit in terms of your skill. So even when we are looking at, you know, you can say the skill sets of an animator, say a 3D animator or a texturing artist, we want to see what uniquely you have done. So most of the showreels would come with a standard box cycle or a bouncing ball, which has done to the death by everyone. But now if you are doing a bouncing ball, and what individuality you have added to that bouncing ball, where I can identify that this is unique and this is
right.
not done by the faculty and handed over to the students.
Yeah, yeah.
So every time a student, especially from design institutes, we would want to see that uniqueness of what you are adding
yeah,
into
adding
your portfolio
to it, yeah.
for which
there
we
is one more question. Rucha, how do I know if a career in animation is design is for me? Yeah, it's a good question.
You would know it because you wouldn't find anything else as charming as
yeah.
that. Because like as I said, I did my engineering, I was a good engineer, I would say, not that bad also. And I was working in Larsen & Toubro in 2006, and then I knew that I wanted to pursue design, and of course, since I was a mechanical engineer, industrial or product design was an obvious choice. But when, so I visited the IDC, Industrial Design Center in Powai. I found a contact and went there. And there I came to know that in the design discipline, there is an animation film design course. The moment I heard, I was like, oh, I can like make animation and I can earn.
Earn,
I said,
yeah.
Then I want to do this. I don't want to do anything else. So it comes as obviously to you.
Yeah,
so
right.
you can't miss it, I would say.
There's one more question from Aniket. I'm a good storyteller, but my design skills are not promising. Can I be an animator? And this is something I also in the institute where a lot of students come, sir, I can't draw much good, but I can tell stories and all that. So what is your views on this?
See, I would say that you need not draw good,
right.
but you have to draw to communicate, because you are in a animation is a visual medium. And when beyond a point, you cannot describe things in words. You at some point in time, you will have to draw
mm-hmm.
and you will have to communicate. So it doesn't matter if, I'm forgetting, Caroline Leaf is a brilliant
Caroline
animator.
Leaf. Yeah, yeah.
So if you just pause any one of her frames, she does a lot of sand animation. And you will say that, you know, give me money to watch this art.
Okay.
This is that bad. But once you see that art in motion, it will blow your mind. So if you're talking about animation, it is not about how good you draw, but it is purely about how well you are telling your story. And if you are saying that you are a good storyteller, then you know, I don't think your skills is just a matter of time. I wouldn't say that don't practice the skill, because that is very important. So the better you are able to draw, the better you are able to communicate. So yes, keep at it, but yeah, I don't think that will come in your way in becoming a good animator anyway.
Mm-hmm. There is one more question. Dhwani, do I engage in live projects while pursuing animation design?
Live project, I didn't
live project is like industry projects, like you work with industry, some of the project which you mm-hmm. comes to, which make we make it as a classroom projects sometimes. So how do you see that? Because it gives that industry idea, how does it work?
See, there are like we had this conversation many a times between me and my partners, and we have both opinions on that. Mm-hmm. We feel that while you are studying, while you are at your design college or in your art college, that is, I think, is the time when you can experiment. That is the time when nobody dictates that this cannot be done or this right. should not be done. That is the time you should like allow your wings to grow. So I would say at least one of your complete project in your school or your education time should be entirely yours, where you do what you want to do,
right?
You want to experiment.
Yep.
And then maybe another project or a final project could be with the industry, where you also get a taste of, you know, how the industry works. But I strongly believe that should be a balance of both.
Right. There's one more question. Aniket, what does a student normally learn in internship? Because I approach you, a lot of our students works in your studio and internship. And this is a genuine question, like, what I'm going to do with that 2 month or 3 month, whatever the internship I'm getting? Entry to the studio.
I think, as I said, it's a part of the balance. As I said, that you know, one of your project is where you let your wings grow, where you let your imagination grow.
Right.
But at the same time, when you are doing your internship, you learn to work with the team, because animation is not always a single man's job. Like, yeah, of course, there are individual animators, but then it takes quite some time to make an animation film. You're drawing 12, 24, sometimes 25 frames for 1 second production. So you always need a team, and you have to understand the dynamics of how working in a team works. So that is something you will definitely learn in your internship. Another thing is that, as I said, if you are a designer, then you also have to balance the viability and the feasibility aspect of a project. So what is the time available? What medium choices do I take? If I have to quickly do something, it cannot be that I always choose a traditional style of animation.
Right.
So if there is a time constraint, if there is a budget constraint, what choices you are making? So these are certain things you will learn while working at the internship with a professional studio.
Right. There is one more question. Tarun, will this course help me enter to game design? Yes, when you look at game design and all that, it's there's a lot of factors, a lot of the fields which helps them. Like, one is character design, storytelling, the background design, all those things. When it comes to game design, it's about strategy, programming, and experiences which get. But definitely the program of animation design, because animation can't be separated with the game design program, because there's a lot of animation things happen, a lot of mechanics things happen. So there is a background, there is a character, special effects are an integral part of nowadays of a storytelling and animation. It definitely help. Yeah, there is one interesting question, and because of this question is very interesting, would you recommend online program for animation design? A lot of online courses are offered in online, so I think this is one question which
see,
how do you see?
I feel everything can be self-taught.
Right.
I totally respect Chetan Sharma. I remember is always given example of a self-taught animator. He's a brilliant animator, illustrator. You should see his work. So yes, you can view some online courses. You can pick up the skills, and if you are dedicated enough, if you are disciplined enough, and if you have that method in madness, you can learn animation. But as I said that, you know, the purpose of design is to expedite the process of evolution. The role of a design institute is to expedite the process of learning. So what maybe you will learn over a period of maybe investing your 5 years, 7 years, 10 years, and whatever exposure you can get through that, versus that entire learning experience is crunched down into maybe a 2 year or 2.5 year course. I don't know the time in, so even like 10 years after passing out from NID, I still go back and talk, you know, in NID I was exposed to this, in NID we learned this. So you go back to your design institute because that's a crash course where you are like totally immersed in your world of learning. And that experience, I don't know to what extent can be entirely replaced by an online platform. It's a lot of peer learning. I remember we did quite a few, in a batch of 10 at NID, we had people from engineering background, from art background, from biochemistry background, wow, the varied mix. And in the initial 1 year, we all had those reservations. Oh, he's not from an art college, so I don't know how good he might be. And we wouldn't respect. But then once we started working together, we made a film, then that respect for each other started growing. We had those clashes and we saw that, okay, I was maybe overjudging this person. And then so a lot of learning in the institute happens through the various kind of profiles that other mm-hmm. people are coming with, which you might miss out in a online learning experience.
Yes, there's one more question. Srushti, what are the various software taught during the course at MIT Institute of Design? We definitely balance, try to software and the idea goes behind it, that all the software learning majorly at in the animation course, it goes with the project. Okay, when it comes to a complex software like Maya is one of the complex software, and like After Effects, one of the popular, and Adobe Photoshop is, which is again one of the known software. So this all been taught by during the course along with the projects and all that. And along with that, there's a special training also. There's a session being kept where students been trained for that. So I think we balance it both.
I would add to that yeah. when we are also looking for candidates from design schools to join our studio, yes, we expect you to be good with your design skills, but we also would want to see that you have certain command on at least one of the execution softwares where you can take a project from concept to the final production and execution stage. So if not all, you have to be mastered at least one to express
right,
yourself.
Right. One more question from Akash. Who are some of the animators whose work unique and you recommend checking out, because that will help our audience to look out, you know, so it will give more definition for them to what is animation.
That will depend how immersed the audience is or how exposed they are to animation. I would say that, you know, this tomorrow, like Saturday and Sunday, there's Mumbai International Film Festival going on. And Michael Dudok is coming,
there,
and
yes.
So for you should not miss that kind of an opportunity, because you should check out his films, the Red Turtle, which
yes.
was Academy
right,
Award winner,
right.
And you should check his films Father and Daughter. I like Fish and the Monk as well, so a big fan of his work. And then apart from that, you should also see a lot of Indian animators work as well. You should see Cricket Studios work as well, I would say.
Yeah.
And within Indian animators, Vaibhav Kumaresh is a very known name. You should see his work, very inspiring. We keep, you know, whenever we feel low,
especially
we call
the Nickelodeon what comes
yeah,
around
yeah.
that.
So whenever yeah. we feel and low sometimes, and you know, then we call up Vaibhav and he gives something he will talk, and that, you know, charges up again, and we are back to work. So yeah, that then Gitanjali Rao's work is very good. You could also see Shilpa Ranade's work. You can of course there's Eek Sora Studio, so
and
very
good
work
now
comes
we are,
out from
now
there.
We are naming at least Indian animators, and
yeah, yeah.
there's a lot of work
there's
is to this.
A lot of very
yeah,
good
yeah.
Work is
yes.
definitely coming out, I would say.
Right, there's one more question. Vaibhav, after bachelor degree in animation design, what other related course can I opt for masters? Yes, you can look for game design. There's a lot of courses on entertainment design, concept art, figurative arts. Those are the things where one can join in and, you know, look for further options.
I would also add into that a lot of interns who came to our studio. So I think Mrigaanka Bhuyan was
yeah,
from MIT.
Yeah, yeah,
he
yeah, yeah.
interned at Girgit, and then he further went into the institute in France. He went into
Gobelin.
He went to. So he did his master's there, and also from our one of our interns went into IDC. So if you are joining a UG course, you can pursue your post graduation in animation. You can we have an animator, Arpit, from our he's passed out from SID. He did his animation design course from India, but then he further mastered in character animation from the US.
Right. Yeah.
So those options are there where you go into certain specific specialization.
I think one more question, Tarun. What are the career options available after this course?
Oh, It's a full.
There's a lot of list. Yeah, it's a huge.
You can be a beggar on the street, or you can be like the topmost animator in the world. So, yeah. The entire.
Yeah, and the video clip which showed that there's a different fields where animators, as a art director, as a storyboard artist, as a key animator, as a character designer, mm-hmm. So many roles are there. So, there's a lot of work over
and
there.
And all you have to do is be just good at any one of this. And if you're good at any one of that, you will definitely.
Yeah.
Be rewarded with pay, for yeah. sure.
So thank you, Swaroop. We ending this webinar. Thank you, everyone, those who are online, and thank for your questions. Thank you.
I make the world graphical.
I add value through my products.
I am an animator.
I am a filmmaker. I develop trends.
I transform designs to reality.
I create environments.
I translate stories to furniture.
I design experiences.
I'm an immersive media designer.
I design mobility.
This is not only a design institute.
This is a design lab.